One of the more useful things to know when making oscilloscope music is how to manipulate phase. By precisely controlling the phase of the sounds we create, we can draw multiple objects on the screen at once, control the brightness of an image, modify only a specific portion of an image, and much more. The idea of phase is fairly simple, but using it to do all of these different things can seem a bit daunting at first. Let's talk about what phase is and look at a few simple applications of phase for oscilloscope music. When we're thinking about audio from a digital signal processing or DSP perspective, there's various different features of the signal we can talk about. Things like amplitude or how loud it is, what is the pitch or frequency, or in the case of this video, phase. We can think of phase a little bit like location. The waveforms we're working with are cyclical or repeat. If I use this sine wave as an example, we'll notice that after the initial up and down motion of the wave, we return to where we started and the pattern repeats. So when I say we can think of phase as a location, I'm using phase as a way to talk about where we are in the repeating pattern of the waveform. The way I've talked about phase here isn't particularly technically precise, but it's a useful perspective for oscilloscope music. It's useful to think of phase as having a range from 0 to 1. From there, if we needed to go across a different range, we can always just scale it to whatever it needs to be. I like to think of it as a percentage. When we're at the beginning of the waveform, our phase is 0, or 0% of the way through the cycle. And at the end of the waveform, our phase is 1, or 100% of the way through the cycle. This is where the phasor tilde object in PD gets its name. It ramps from 0 to 1, or in terms of percentages, 0 to 100%. And while it does produce a sawtooth waveform, it can also be used to repeatedly cycle through the phase of some other waveform automatically. To demonstrate what this looks like for the scope, I've put together this little PD patch. There is some extra stuff in here that you might not understand, just ignore that for now. What I really want to focus on is these things right here. I've set up the patch to draw two sine waves. On the left, we have the usual setup. The output of this cut equal tilde object is the same as a phasor, and in order to make it draw a line across the whole screen, i.e. from minus 1 to 1 instead of 0 to 1, I have to rearrange it, so I multiply it by 2 and subtract 1. And for the y values, it's just a cosine wave offset a quarter phase, also known as a sine wave. So we have the rearranged phasor controlling the x position and the sine wave controlling the y position. Now on the right, I have the same setup, but this time I have a number box to pick the exact spot in the phase I want to see. Right now it's at 0, so the circle is drawn at the beginning of the waveform. And when I slide it up to 1, it moves to the end. If I move beyond 1, it'll just wrap around to the beginning of the waveform again. So, phase is just a way to talk about where we are in the waveform. If it's 0, we're at the beginning. If it's 1, we're at the end. If it's anything else, we're somewhere in the middle. Let's use our improved knowledge of phase and get a better understanding of the circle example from the previous video. Remember, in order to draw a circle, we learned that we had to implement these two parametric equations. X equals cosine of t, and y equals sine of t. The parameter t in those equations is just phase. So we've got this phasor object, which goes through the entire phase for us at whatever frequency we specify. That's our t parameter. Then, the cosine tilde object takes that phase as input and sends out the point on the cosine wave that corresponds to its input phase. The addition of 0.25 before cosine on the right is just so that we can use a sine wave for our parametric equation. Cosine waves are just a quarter phase offset from a sine wave. Since sine waves are available by default in Oscilloscope, the only real difference is that we had to scale the phase by 2π first. Otherwise, it's basically the same. Another aspect of phase that is important to understand is that things can be in phase or out of phase. When we're talking about things being in or out of phase, we're interested in the relationship between two or more waveforms. We want to know, how does one waveform's phase relate to another's? Are they the same, in phase, or are they different, out of phase? When two waves are in phase, they will add together and create something louder than what we started with. Right now, the sine and cosine wave we're using to draw the circle on the screen are out of phase. They're not completely out of phase, though, so we're still adding up to a waveform larger than we started with. If I change the offset on this cosine wave to be 0, though, we'll see that both waveforms are exactly the same, leading to this really large combined wave and a diagonal line on the screen. As I cycle through the different possible relationships, we slowly get more and more out of phase. Eventually, this combined waveform turns into a flat line. Both waves are perfectly out of phase, and when we add them together, they cancel each other out. We also get that diagonal line again. If I attach a phaser to this offset, we can produce this cool rotating effect, which is really just the two waveforms going in and out of phase. Messing around with this frequency can lead to some pretty interesting images as well. Let's see how we can go about manipulating phase to control things about our image. The first thing we could try is, instead of letting our phase go through its intended range of 0 to 1, resulting in a complete cycle through the phase of our circle, what if we only went through, say, 70% of the phase, or from 0 to 0.7? I'll just scale the output of this phaser by 0.7. We'll see that the circle no longer gets drawn all the way around. If I play with this number, we can see that it's also possible to have the circle get drawn in the opposite direction if I multiply the phase by a negative number, or even take more than one rotation if I go larger than one. Another thing we can do is have the phase start somewhere other than the beginning. If we add an offset to the phase, we could start it halfway through the circle instead. This can be fun to automate with low-frequency oscillators, or LFOs for short. We can then watch the beam slowly trace out different parts of the circle. The setup we have here is, in fact, how that effect works under the hood in Oscilloscope, although they have added a few special things there as well. I call this effect trace because it traces out different parts of the image. Let's expand on this idea of only using parts of the phase and draw the circle with dashes. As I explain how to make this work, I'll primarily be using this PD patch, but I'll also be following along with Oscilloscope, so you can see how it's implemented over there as well. The end result will look something like this. Here's our circle example again, but I've placed the part that draws the circle into a sub-patch, and given myself some space to add things just to clean it up a little bit. On the side over here, I'll be adding graphs at various times to help us analyze what's going on with the phase. Currently, I've only got one graph showing the final phase. I'm going to pick 3 as our number of dashes, just so we can have a number in our head while we think about how the patch is working. Since we want 3 dashes, we'll need 3 different locations along the circle. And to keep it simple, we'll keep them evenly spaced out and divide our circle into thirds. Our locations will be 0 thirds, 1 thirds, and 2 thirds through the phase of the circle. We're not using 3 thirds because that's the same thing as 1 and would take us back to the beginning of the circle. This will give us 3 dots instead of dashes, but this ends up actually being pretty close to what we want. So we'll start by implementing this first. We'll take the output of our phaser and multiply it by 3. Now, the phaser is sending out every number from 0 to 3, so we'll floor the output using expert tilde so that we only get 0, 1, and 2. And finally, we can divide it all by 3. Our phase is now exclusively cycling through the fractions 0 thirds, 1 thirds, and 2 thirds, giving us our 3 dots along the circle. I'll slow down the frequency of the phaser so that we can see its output more clearly. Looking at our graph, we can see that the final phase is cycling through 3 values. And if we look at the output along our chain of objects here, we can see it cycling through 0, 1, and 2 thirds as expected. If we wanted to change the number of dots, we can just have a number box control all the spots where we have the number 3 and change them to whatever we like. For now, I'll keep it at 3. Okay, so we've got 3 dots, but these aren't dashes. Or we could say that they're dashes with 0 length, but still, this isn't what we want. What we could do, though, is add an offset to each dot. If I add a number box here, I can now change the location of these dots along the circle. When I reach an offset of 1, we're back to where we started. What we want then is something that will create a continuous offset for each dot, ramping from 0 to 1 so that we can get a full length dash. The solution is to create a secondary phaser in sync with the main one here at the top, using wrap tilde. To do this, I'll use the phase we scaled by 3 before we floor it as the input. Wrap tilde is modulo 1 for signals in PD, and since our input ranges from 0 to 3, we'll cycle from 0 to 1 3 times, once for each dot. If I graph the output, the relationship is a bit clearer to see. The top graph shows which dash we happen to be on, 0, 1, or 2. Below it, we can see the output of the secondary phaser I'm using as an offset for each dash. Notice how it's perfectly in sync with each one, ramping from 0 to 1 over the whole length of the current dash, before resetting back to 0 at the start of the next one. You'll have noticed, however, that we're covering the entire gap between each dash, resulting in us drawing the whole circle again. Remember, our positions are fractions, 0 thirds, 1 thirds, and 2 thirds. Since each dash's ramping offset is ending by adding 1 to the numerator of each of them, the result is that each dash is ending where the next one begins. But if we remember from our previous example, where we traced through the phase of the circle, we can just multiply this secondary phase by some constant to make it not go from 0 to 1 anymore. Using these two number boxes, we can now control the number of dashes as well as their length. Here are some variations of this that I came up with. This one has unique lengths for each dash. And this one has the dashes wiggle by adding a secondary offset. In this example, I've combined the trace and dash effects. Each effect is put into its own subpatch, which helps keep the patch from getting too messy, and it makes it a bit easier to understand what's going on. We can also start to see the underlying structure of something that happens in oscilloscope music a lot of the time. We have something generating phase here at the top, some effects we want to apply to the image, and then we end with the stuff we want to draw at the bottom. This isn't how every patch ever is designed, but this idea crops up a lot. What's also interesting here is that order matters. If I trace and then dash, I get something that looks like this. We trace through a circle that has been dashed. If I dash and then trace, however, the dashes are attached to the trace and stick around even when I modify it. What's even cooler here, though, is that the phase manipulation we did, or in fact, any phase manipulation we could think of, is going to be independent of the circle we're drawing. We could put anything in place of the circle, and it would still work.